This episode is presented by Five Stones Jam Company. Indulge your senses with Five Stones Jam Company, where every jar is not just jam, but a handcrafted masterpiece. Bursting with unique flavors, their small batch jams are created with all natural ingredients, ensuring that every spread is free from preservatives and rich in pure, flavorful goodness. With Five Stones Jam Company, say goodbye to mundane and hello to delightful taste bud tingling joy, because in life, there's no room for ordinary, only the extraordinary. Taste the difference today with Five Stones Jam Company. You can order them online at fivestonesjamco.com on the screen below. They ship to all 50 states, and they have some new stuff coming out for their spring collection coming out in around mid-March. Go check them out. Let us know what you think.
What up? Welcome back to Take a Bitch. How you doing, Maxwell?
How we doing?
All right.
So just a quick thing for the fans. I want them to know that Billy has challenged me to stay under 40 minutes or at 40 minutes this episode.
It's every episode.
So feel free to place your bets over or under. And yeah. Knowing Billy, he's going to take the over, but he's not a betting man, and he'll tell you that himself.
Oh, I'm going to take the over.
This is the one bet he's going to take.
I have never seen you hit your mark when it comes to staying, actually anything to do with time. I've never seen you hit the mark, ever. So, I would be very shocked to see you hit the 40 minutes, but.
So why don't we just get right into it then at that point?
This
episode we kind of allotted the Eastern preview. We're going doing our divisional previews as we always do. Let's start with the AL East because there's a lot to talk about in the AL East. It's arguably the best division in baseball. Mm-hmm. There's speculation about the NL West. I'm picking the AL East as the strongest division in baseball in terms of talent. Competition. The only thing that really is going to matter is, are the Red Sox going to hit 78 wins, which I don't think so.
Yeah.
Because the rest of the league, the rest of the division is going to beat up on the Red Sox, especially now without Giolito maybe not being ready for opening day.
Yeah.
You don't know what that's going to be like. You know? So, I mean, quickly, let's go with the Red Sox because there's not a lot of optimism in Boston. Alex Cora's in the last year of his deal, by the way. They lost Adam Duvall, who's still a free agent. Justin Turner, Paxton. Really, that's the only big names that actually matter. Marcelo Mayer, the top prospect, is still a year or two away. Nick York, same thing, still a year or two away. Some guys that they were really banking on being ready within the next year or so. Kyle Teal, they drafted him last year. Really, it's a lot of the same guys from last year with Boston.
Yeah, basically.
They added Tyler O'Neill, which I did like that move. I will say. Yeah, they replaced Verdugo with O'Neill, and I like that a lot.
Maybe.
You're not the biggest fan of that one?
No, you know what you're going to get out of Doogie. Tyler O'Neill we've seen him at like, an MVP level, and then we've seen him in the dark depths of being tragically terrible.
Sent to the shadow realm.
So, he's always been a good defender, though.
Yes.
And a pretty good base runner, and he's jacked. So, I'll give him those three things.
I think having a good defender, especially in left field at Fenway, is kind of key.
Really? I feel like you could kind of throw a monkey out there and you'll be fine. It's so small.
Playing the wall and everything, but
yeah, if you know how to catch a baseball, you could learn to play that fucking ball. Again, a monkey.
Would you say right field's a little right and center are a little tougher in Fenway then?
Significantly.
Okay.
Dude, significantly. Not remotely close. Left field is the easiest position in Boston. Easiest position by far. Easier than DH.
Listen, David Ortiz made the DH look easy. They also had CJ Cron as for the power off the bench, which you know, again, I think it's a good move. They're relying on Tristan Cassis.
He's a full signee.
He wasn't. It's not as an NRI.
Yeah, non-roster. That's what I thought.
Yeah. But Fangraphs rejects him to be on the bench. In terms of their rotation, it's nothing special. It's the same group they tried out last year. Pivetta, Bello, or Bayo, sorry.
Bayo, come on, man.
Who got an extension today.
Did he?
Yep, yep. What is it? 5 years, $55 million, I believe. Or 4 years, $55 million. So I guess there's faith there. Cutter Crawford, Tanner Houck, and Garrett Whitlock. Really, that's, again, nothing to really write home about with Boston. They brought in Vaughn Grissom as well. Giolito. There's not much there to write home about. They're waiting on Liam Hendricks to come back from Tommy John.
Yes.
In the second half of the year. But, yeah, Boston's not going to be too competitive this year. 78 wins last year. I don't know what their line is set at this year. But.
My apologies. 1 second.
No, you're good.
Their Pacoda is set at 79 and 83.
I'll take the under.
I'm thinking the other. What do you have them at? Did you put down records or no?
Give them 76, 77-ish.
That's what I put, 76. 76 and 86.
So, Billy, let me ask you this real quick. Especially the AL East now. Yeah. Who is your favorite?
Who's in my this favorite?
Division? Like, to win the division?
Orioles.
You're right. It's almost a lock that they're the favorite, I'd say.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty hard to go against them.
The youth movement is insane there, too. Considering four of their top five prospects are projected to make the majors this year.
Mm-hmm.
And they all look the same, by the way. I don't know if you saw that meme.
Yeah, yeah, the long factory, the blonde hair.
Just blonde, awkwardly white, yeah.
Yeah. But, dude, you know what's the craziest thing that I keep seeing, too, is that Adley Rutschman is older than Juan Soto. Yeah. Adley Rutschman is older than Juan Soto. Yeah. No. Mm-hmm. How crazy is that? Like, think about that. Adley Rutschman got the call up to the big
league. That's so weird.
What, 2 years ago? Like, a year and a half ago? And Juan Soto has been up since 2018.
My perception of time is so fucked right now.
Isn't that crazy?
That's Juan Soto absolutely came up at, insane.
Juan Soto came up at 19 when Adley Rutschman was a sophomore in college.
That's absolutely insane. Was that, that was probably the same year that Adley Rutschman tackled Christian McCaffrey, right?
It must have been. It had to be, right?
That feels like forever. Oh, no. I think Rutschman was a freshman.
Yeah, so it was the year after.
Which is also one of the weirdest things.
Yes. Just all weird different lines. But
So you said the Orioles are the favorite, right? And that rightfully so.
Mm-hmm.
They brought in Corbin Burns.
Yes.
For DL Hall. We touched on that a couple weeks ago.
Yes.
Give me a guy that you think will make or break this Orioles team. I mean, the lineup's relatively the same.
Mm-hmm.
Fangraphs pencils in Jackson Holliday to make the opening day roster at second base.
I agree.
You
no
think
point
so?
Not to. Yeah, no point not to.
Okay.
Remember, like, the incentive, they took away that.
Right, the service time
division. Yeah, so there's no reason not to. They're in win mode now. They have new ownership that's not going to try and scam anything.
Right.
Because, like, it's either just do it on opening day. Like, the kid's clearly ready. So, have him break camp or wait until September and keep him under the 130, you know?
Like, right, and that way he can't win the Rookie of the Year, can't gain the...
Yeah, it makes no sense. So, just let him break camp. He's ready. Do it. I'm not really sure how the defense all plays out. I haven't, you know, really, I've only ever seen the kid really hit, and I've seen him practice field, but if he is as good of a five-tool athlete as we're being advertised, what do they have? Ryan O'Hearn, right?
At first base.
Yeah. Or do they have a third?
Jordan Westberg.
Jordan Westberg.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I mean, all right. I They're just, it's just such a complete lineup, top to bottom.
Yeah.
And Kobe Mayo is another guy who might come up this year, play third base, first base. Yeah. If O'Hearn struggles,
Colton Cowser is right there on the cusp.
He's having a hell of a spring.
Yes. Where's
he might run that outfield.
What's his name? Heston Kjerstad. Is he projected to come up this year or no?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yep. Makes sense.
The only one that in the top five, what wasn't was Basalo, the catcher.
Okay. Yeah. I mean,
cause he's still young. Yeah. Yeah.
They got it. They got a pretty decent catcher. So
I'd say so. So who's your guy to watch in Baltimore?
My guy to watch?
Yeah. Or your make or break guy, maybe.
For them. The make or break. I'm going to go Grayson Rodriguez.
I like that pick. I'm going to pick him as the
X factor. They got a great pen. They have a great lineup. Now they have a true ace in Corbin Burnes. This team is built almost perfectly. And it's almost all like internally built too, which is awesome.
Which is insane. And if you can get Bradish back too around right before the All-Star break, mm-hmm. that's another huge add.
Yes. Yes.
To where you don't need to go out and get a frontline starter or a number two, mm-hmm. two or three. You have Bradish coming back. John Means, if he can even be a shell of his former self, you have that back end of the rotation covered. Mm-hmm. And Cole Irvin could be more of a swing guy for you.
Yes.
So the flexibility with the rotation, if they can get healthy, is huge in Baltimore.
Yeah.
So I like the Grayson Rodriguez pick a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, he locks down that rotation. That's it. You know, that would be so key. What are you gonna say?
I'm gonna go Gunnar Henderson. If he can have that, avoid that sophomore slump, mm-hmm. the Orioles are gonna be in a great spot. But if he has that sophomore slump, I have a bad feeling that he's very much one of those guys that when he goes, the offense goes. And you don't want to see that from a team like the Orioles, but I think that's kind of where it's at.
Right.
So if Gunnar can keep that momentum going and you know, build off the Rookie of the Year that he won last year and all that, the impressive, you know, hitting it and even the defense too. Mm-hmm. If he can just elevate his game just a little bit more, this team is going to be dangerous.
Yeah.
100 plus wins easy.
Yeah, and speaking of their record, crazily enough, Dakota has them at 86.9 and 75.1. So 87 wins.
Let me hammer the over real quick.
I'm not just hammering
to the ground.
The over, I think they are probably the best team in baseball.
Over the Dodgers?
Yes. Dodgers overrated. They have
that. Yamamoto and his 9 ERA. Right.
That's also a little misrepresented.
Yeah.
But I think Baltimore might be the best team in baseball. I think you could say
definitely the most balanced.
I think they might be the best team in baseball.
Okay. I like it. I like that.
I have the. What do you have them at wins wise? What would you give them?
101.
101. It's a repeat of last year.
Yeah, 101, 102.
I'm gonna go 103 and 59.
All right, I like it.
103.
Like, and they're your favorite in the division by far, and I don't blame.
Yeah, I mean, also like they added maybe the best pitcher in baseball.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Like. Just how do you go against that? This team already won 101 with a very mid pitching staff.
Yeah.
A very mid rotation. Kyle Bradish was their ace.
And he was fantastic, don't get me wrong.
Yeah. So.
So if he can come back healthy, pair him with Burnes at the top of that rotation.
Yep. You know, exactly.
Tyler Wells, Dean Kramer, if Grayson Rodriguez could pitch to the potential.
Yeah, Tyler Wells.
That is a dangerous.
Oh, well, he had top 10 in WHIP, I believe.
Yep. So listen, that's a rotation that you don't want to face in October. I'm sorry, that's just a dangerous rotation.
Dangerous rotation.
I mean, talking about rotations in the division,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to just say it flat out. The Yankees are banking on such a bounce back year from that entire rotation not named Gerrit Cole.
Yes.
And I'm not going to say it's a make or break player for the Yankees. It's the rotation.
That's what I have to. Look at that.
Because
have their rotation.
It literally, the bullpen, listen, the Yankees pen is one of the top units in the league.
They have been for the past, three, 4 years, so.
Right, and they bring Caleb Ferguson, Victor Gonzalez, Loaiza, a full season with him healthy again.
Mm-hmm.
Marinaccio, got a year under his belt, full year.
Yeah.
This is Tommy Canley.
Probably see Will Warren come up too.
Yep. Tommy Canley can kind of get healthy. I don't know what his deal is. Scott Efros, I think he's out for the year again. I'm not sure. I know he had back surgery.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
In December, I'm not really sure about that. But again, even then, this is still a top unit. Without two key guys, Canley and Efros. You bring up Will Warren. You bring up, who's the other one?
The other what?
The other arm. Hampton. Even as a swing guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the other thing. Hampton might get a crack at the rotation, I think.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously, we're not talking about Soto, we're not talking about the Verdugo ads because we mentioned that already a couple weeks back.
Yeah.
Obviously, deep as the Yankee lineup,
mm-hmm.
it definitely helps. It gives a team more of a reason to pitch Aaron Judge.
Yes.
Which is never a good thing.
Yeah.
So, but after Judge, Rizzo's got to stay healthy. If Glaber can continue to be consistent,
yeah, I'm going with Glaber.
The rest of the
lineup, though.
Yeah, it's tough.
Is
very much a high potential but high risk.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all
that's what you look at with Rodon, Stroman, Schmidt, even Nestor. If Nestor can get healthy.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Yankees season is gonna be high risk, high reward.
Mm-hmm.
What's their over under at?
Pecota has them at 94.3.
They
have them as the top. As the top, yeah. They have them as the second best team in the AL and the fourth best team in baseball.
You said 94?
94.
I don't want to say under. But I think they're going to be hovering around the 92 to 94 range.
All right.
That's if the rotation has a bounce back.
Mm-hmm.
That's the big thing.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I have them at 91. Yeah. They were at 82 and 80.
You and I are the same ballpark.
Like. That entire rotation has to stay healthy. That entire rotation has to prove that they can be healthy and pitch well through a full season. If they get a healthy Nestor, Stroman, Rodon, and who's their five guy?
Nestor, Clark Schmidt.
Clark Schmidt got traded.
Nope.
What?
Michael King got traded.
Oh, Michael King got traded. Clark Schmidt. Oh, Clark Schmidt. I like Clark Schmidt. He might end up being the second best pitcher in this rotation, honestly.
I agree. Yeah. Because Rodon, according to Macca, is Kentucky.
And
by the way, I laughed so hard when I read that.
This is a pretty old rotation, actually, looking at it.
Yeah.
Like all these guys, Clark Schmidt's going to be the only one under 30.
Under 30.
At the end of this year.
That's why Will Warren and Chase Hampton really have to come up and
yes, deliver.
Just take hold of their rotation spots.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, their bullpen is nice. I like their arms in the bullpen. And yeah, Yeah, I don't think that they jumped 12 games better that Pekoda is
seeing. I understand Soto brings a whole new level to the lineup.
100%.
I get
Soto,
that.
Soto is a once-in-a-lifetime hitter and a once-in-a-lifetime offensive player.
For 1 year, yeah. Listen, I get it.
Yeah. But 12 wins?
Yeah.
That's a little crazy.
Yeah.
Assuming that Rodon has a bounce-back season, Stroman takes the first half of last year and does it over the entire season, Clark Schmidt improves, and Nestor stays healthy and repeats 2022? Sure. Put me on board, 95 wins. Sure. But all that needs to happen, that's a lot to ask. Not going to happen. 91, still making the playoffs.
Let's head down to Tampa where, let's be real, it's a dogfight for second, third, and fourth place between Tampa, Toronto, and the Yankees. Right? I mean, how do you see this playing out? Because for me, I see Tampa in third, and then the Jays falling to fourth, especially losing Matt Chapman.
Yeah, they're right in the same realm. I think the Jays and the Rays are literally right there. Like, they're going to end up within a couple games of each other, I think, honestly.
Yeah, there was a 10-win difference last year, yes. Which was, I mean, the Rays also had a very, very hot start last year.
Yeah, where they were impossible to beat a month and a half, 2 months?
Yeah. I will say, I do love what the Rays did with their rotation. It's Eflin Savali, Zach Littell, Ryan Pepiot, and Taj Bradley. Some very, very quality arms. By the way, according to Fangraphs, Taj Bradley is the only member of the pitching staff that's projected that was drafted by the Rays.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't think that's crazy. That's crazy.
It's not realistically, like, when you think about how the Rays operate, but when you say it, it sounds kind of crazy.
Yeah. I mean, let's go back.
I mean, realistically, again, with the Rays, they added a couple of bench guys. They didn't really add too much outside of Pepiot, Maton, and Tyler Alexander, but it was, you know, it's not much there. Should be getting back Jeffrey Springs early on in the season.
Yeah.
Drew Rasmussen.
Another key on.
Could be coming back by the middle of the year. So they have reinforcements coming in.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how much better they got.
Yeah.
And then I don't know if you have any make or break names on Tampa, because it's really just kind of the whole thing. If the analytics works,
it's, yeah, I mean, they're a hard team to really go over. I picked Brandon Lau as the X factor for them.
I would say Yandy Diaz for me, because if he can build off last year, they're going to be
okay. I think he very easily should. Very easily will.
Good.
But they need Brandon Lau to stay healthy.
Yes.
He's such a key bat for them and really a leader. He's got to be like the oldest on the offense, really, besides Yandy. But I mean, they do have a very good team. And Junior Caminero will, he's got to be up at some point this year. And they got a nice bench. I mean, they're going to be right. They're going to be fighting for a playoff spot till the end.
Yeah. Yeah. What's the Pekoda have, Matt?
Pekoda has at 87.5. What do you have, Matt?
See, I don't want to count out the Rays at all. I don't want to say under 90, but at the same time, they don't impress me.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing stands out with the Rays, as it never really does, but
yeah,
I'm going to hover around 88, 89.
I'm at 89.
Yeah. Right. And in Toronto, what?
No, I was going to say, all right, the Jays.
Yeah, in Toronto, I mean, the big thing is they lost Matt Chapman, so Fangraphs has penciled in at third base, IKF.
Yep. And then the other big thing is they signed Daniel Vogge.
Yep, and Justin Turner's a DH.
Yes.
By the way, Matt Chapman going to the Giants, 3 for 54 with an option for a fourth year. Yeah. Great move for the Giants. We'll break that down in about 2 weeks when we do our West preview. But solid, solid move for the Giants. Two opt-outs for Matt Chapman as well. Scott Boras, another L.
Or W. You never know.
We'll do a whole side pod on that one. Side quest.
That's overrated. He got overpaid.
All right. Again, it's really just a lot of the same with Jays. Same rotation except for Ryu. They have Bowden Francis being penciled in there.
Yeah.
I'm not really too familiar with him.
Yeah, it's tough.
That's really, it's a matter of, does Alec Manoa get out of his own head?
Yeah. That's everything, right? For the rotation and really the team. I mean,
that's the make or break. Yeah.
For me. I guess the other thing you could say is maybe Vladdy, you know, hope that he returns to old form of
doesn't get hit with the cover jinx.
Yeah. You know, the superstar offense. And good, he plays very good defense at first base too.
Yeah,
but Pecota has them at 88 wins. What do you have them at?
I go
88, 87. 87,
I
have them at. Yeah. So
again, the big thing is with them is with Manoa.
Yeah, yeah, Manoa. Like, and that's huge because Manoa was really on the fast track to being their longtime ace, really.
Yeah. Their next Roy Halladay type starter.
Yeah. And he was so phenomenal in 21 and 22.
Mm-hmm. And just decided to jump off a cliff last year.
He just, yeah.
I don't know if it's mental or what, but if Manoa can get back on track, terrible, even to half of what he did in 21, 22.
Yeah.
Jays team is totally different.
Yeah, they got Gausman and Berrios and Bassett. Great three.
But if you could add a top tier out of Alec Manoa, that is just,
then
you
know,
we're looking at a rotation where you're rivaling like the Orioles with Bradish, Burns, Rodriguez.
Yeah.
And Wells.
The Yankees if healthy. Right, I mean,
this is one of the deepest divisions in baseball.
This division, yes, is super deep, but also, like, their pitching is just so one way or the other. Mm-hmm. You know, like, they're going to be either phenomenal and healthy, or they're going to be terrible and hurt.
High risk, high reward. Yeah.
Yep. Exactly.
So you have the Orioles winning the division, right?
Oh, easy. Yeah. Blowing them away. Yeah. I think I have them 12 games over the Yankees.
Yeah, you're at 103, right?
Yeah, 103.
So here's the crazy thing. It's like the AL East is very competitive, but we know who the division winner is, clear cut. Yeah. Same thing in the NL East. We know who the division winner is. And there's a lot that could go down in this division that could cause some chaos. We'll start with the inevitable, the Atlanta Braves, who have somehow turned Chris Sale into the next coming of Jesus again.
Spring training.
I know, but still.
Just gotta knock it down. If it's good or bad, just remember it's spring training. Don't get your hopes up or down. Now the Braves are obviously inevitable.
crazy.
They're built really well. That's really it. I mean, you can't really say anything else, right?
As much as we hate the Braves, they've built the team the right way.
Mm-hmm.
Locking up their young stars, the talent, fleecing other teams. They've done it the way that you have to build a super team.
I gotta say though, these players are dumb. Like, think about like Acuna
saying yes to these deals. You mean
he'd be a free agent at the end of this year, right? Yeah.
Who, Acuna? Yeah.
And he'd be going into his age 27 season next year.
Dude, think about the pay he'd be in the same free agent class as Juan Soto.
That's what I'm saying.
So the market would be completely inflated.
Yeah. Like,
Ozzie Albies would have been a free agent this past year.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Like, these guys are locked
up. Matt Olson would have been a free agent this year.
On these terrible, well, he got he's the only one that they're overpaying. But
yeah, but again, it's crazy.
I gotta see what Acuña,
his value would be,
what his contract is right now. No, his value is 35+ million a year.
Yeah,
sheesh, dude, he's locked up for another 5 years.
At what, like 16 annually?
17.
Yeah, that's stupid.
Oh my God, this was
absolutely last year. It was stupid.
Would have been free agent next year. They bought up 4 years of free agency at $17 million a year. That is crazy. Whoever
that's
his,
highway robbery.
Whoever his
agent
is should be and cash. We'll
blast into the sun,
terrible dude. Oh, anyway,
that pisses me off now. The only ads they really did was they brought in, they traded Kelenic for Kelenic,
mm-hmm.
Who's a factor into the their everyday left fielder.
Yeah.
They brought in David Fletcher as an NRI. I kind of like that move. I've always been high on Fletcher. I know he's very much a hit or miss guy.
David Fletcher?
Yeah.
The former Angel?
Yeah.
I'll give him, he has one thing and one thing only.
What you got?
The guy can make contact with a baseball.
I know, and he's going to hit like 600 now. This is with the Braves.
He has the best, I think, every year that he had played, like he qualified, he had the best
contact rate.
Contact rate. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was like not even close, like better than Luis Arraez. Just put it in perspective. You just can't put it put the barrel on the ball.
Yeah. Yeah. They brought in Chris Sale, Ronaldo Lopez.
Yes.
Aaron Bummer. By the way, first year that Ronaldo Lopez and Lucas Giolito are not on the same team.
Yeah. For now.
Kind of weird.
For now,
yeah, Gio's gonna come over on the once Max Fried goes down inevitably.
You pronounced it wrong, by the way.
What?
You said Bummer?
Yeah.
It's Boomer.
It's not.
It is. Go on, fucking.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No way. I'm checking reference right now.
Just correct yourself and move on. So, we as Mets fans, we know what is inevitably gonna happen with Jared Kelenic. That's the one that we have, and Luis Guillorme. We know that they are inevitably going to be phenomenal players. Jared Kelenic is still young enough. He has a chance to be a very, very good player for his major league career. Luis Guillorme he's got to be 30, right? He'll be 30 this year. So he will, he's going to be probably one of the best bench bats in baseball. He'll play a great utility. Orlando Arcia, I would say watch out, because Luis Guillorme can put the bat on the ball much better than he can. And he plays probably just as good of a defense, if not better. So
Travis d'Arnaud is still an elite backup catcher.
Yeah.
Listen. What's the Pecota total for the Braves? Let's just get this out of the way. I don't want to talk about them, honestly.
Like, I mean, there's really nothing else to talk about them. They're at 100.6.
Yeah, I'm going to say 100 wins.
I am at 101.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I fucking hate the Braves, dude.
Me too. They're annoying.
They're cheating. They have to be.
Last year, I mean, you can't tell me otherwise. You got it.
Yeah.
You look at those numbers, those strikeout and walk rates, and see how they differed from previous years.
It's crazy.
I would love to see how they turn out this year.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they were another team that was unbeatable in the first couple months of the season.
Pissed me off.
Anyway, next.
You want to go to the Marlins next, or you want to go to our miserable Mets?
No, Marlins.
Let's go to the Marlins. All right. The Marlins brought in Tim Anderson. Ooh. That's really the big thing. Brought in Nick Gordon, Vidal Bruján, Christian.
Who's the first Bethancourt. One you said?
Oh, sorry. Jackie. Right,
thank you.
Jackie Robinson. All right. The second coming of Jackie Robinson.
Yeah, so they brought in Jackie. Dude. He's going to be their starting shortstop.
Yeah. The big thing with the Marlins this year, Sandy Alcantara not pitching this year.
Yeah.
Tommy John surgery. It's a huge blow to this
franchise.
Really high upside Marlins rotation.
Yeah.
I was telling you before we got, clicked record, I kind of like how this Marlins rotation shaped up.
Yeah.
between it's Lizardo Perez, AJ Puck, who I feel like will probably end up going back into the pen. Edward Cabrera, Trevor Rogers. Mm-hmm. Braxton Garrett has shoulder soreness, so he may end up factoring back into the rotation again.
Yeah.
And I really like it.
Yeah.
Max Meyer should be healthy by now. You know, he had a cup of coffee early, you know, what was it, 2 years ago now? In 22?
Was that 2 years ago?
We had Tommy John, right?
Damn, dude. If that was 2 years ago, I got to go do something because time has flew.
Let's see. Yeah, 2022. Yep.
Damn, dude.
Yeah. So, you know, he should factor into the rotation at some capacity.
Yeah.
I know the Marlins aren't going to push him, but I like the upside of this Marlins rotation. I really do. And they're all relatively young. AJ Puck is the oldest that I listed at 29 years old, pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah, they're all young.
He's the oldest, yeah. The pitching staff as a whole is very young.
Yes. High upside arms. We know what the Marlins have been building.
Yeah, they've been doing the 2015 Mets way. Build it around the arms, and you'll find hitting eventually.
They've been trying. It just has not panned out.
Right.
But let's see. Where's Pecota have him at? Pecota has him at 80 wins. What do you have him at? There were 84 wins last year.
I'm going to go split the difference. They're going to be a 500 team.
Okay. 81.
Yeah.
I have them being drastically worse at 74 and 88. I do not think
I can see that too. That's the thing. I could see that too.
Yeah. Their offense does not wow me at all. They lost Jorge Soler, who was a big, big, big power bat for them.
Right. Now they're relying on Sanchez and De La Cruz to be those power bats. Yeah. And Jake Berger.
Yeah. I mean, Jake Berger, like, this offense isn't terrible. But they're not a playoff team right now.
You know, I didn't ask you about an X factor for the Braves because who cares at this point?
Their X factor, the Braves, by the way, because their pitching staff is kind of mid and always fucking hurt.
It's old.
All these guys always get hurt. But yeah. Marlins, I have Chaz Chisholm.
Chaz Chisholm?
Yes.
All right, I like that. I like that actually.
Yeah.
See, I'm going to go Avisaíl Garcia.
Center field. Avisaíl? That's a good one. I mean, like, I feel like Avisaíl, like, we know we're getting out of him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, at this point, it's the same thing.
You know, at age 32, Jimmy, age 33, you know, is there anything left in the tank? Because obviously he's declining.
No.
Gotta know if there's something left in the tank at that
point. He's going to hit his 250. He's going to hit 15 to 25 home runs and call it a day. Call it a year. All right.
Yeah. Garcia, Sanchez, just that those outfield bats for me.
Let's skip to the Nationals quick, just because
There's nothing there.
They're not good. They're still building.
They're not great. They brought in Gallo, Eddie Rosario,
and Dylan Floro.
I won't lie. I do like Nick Senzel.
Yeah, I heard. Here's my prediction.
What do you got?
He's going to make the All-Star game. and then in the All-Star game, he's going to tear his ACL. Watch. Book it. This is the third year in a row I've guessed it.
Every team gets a representative, so I guess, you know, hey, this might be
it's your possible.
Year. This might be your year if it's not Lane Thomas.
Lane Thomas is obviously the best player on this team.
By far.
And the X factor I have is Mackenzie Gore, Pecota.
How is Carter Kieboom still allowed to be on the roster?
Dude, isn't it crazy? Pecota.
He's also older than Juan Soto, by the way.
Yes. Pecota has them at 58 wins.
They had 71 last year.
71. They have them at 58.
Which was shocking in its own right.
Yes. What do you have them at? They have them at 58. They won 71.
I like Pecota at 58, but I don't, like, it's the Nationals. Like, you know, it's good. They're going to be annoying.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 64.
I'm at 67.
Okay, yeah. They're that team where they're really annoying. They're going to win games they shouldn't.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. They're going to start the year terrible. And then they're going to...
But like August, they're going to start turning around. In September, they're going to be like especially, the best team in baseball.
Especially watch. If they bring up some of those young kids, like Dylan Cruz.
I was going to say Cruz.
Like, there's a shot that he gets up. James Wood. Like, these guys are they're very close. So
James Wood is unreal.
Like, it's a throwaway year, too. So it's very easy for them to bring up these kids to just get them looks at MLB.
Play free. And they're playing freely with no expectations.
Exactly.
Like, Cade Cavallo is going to come back from his Tommy John, and there's going to be no expectations with that. But that's an arm that we've been talking about for years.
Exactly.
Pair him with Josiah Gray, who, you know, again, there's no expectations. So he can pitch loosely, and he's got the stuff. Mackenzie Gore, again, another guy, no expectations, has the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You pair that with Cade Cavallo, you're looking at a very good top three down the line.
Yeah.
You know?
All right.
But they are getting old.
Yes.
The longer we wait. Do you want to start go with misery now or later?
Well, yeah, let's just get it over with. Because
the New York
Mets. I already know what I have to say about the Phillies. I already know what I have to say about the Mets. Oh.
Yeah, why don't you start with the Mets? I think my timer's at 4 minutes left.
Their key additions are Harrison Bader, Adrian Hauser, Sean Manaea, Luis Severino. Those are the key additions. Three of them are pitchers who will be in the starting rotation, which makes sense considering that was the exact issue last year. This is a team in transition, a team that is not like, listen, this is the same team, the same offense, aside from Eduardo Escobar and Mark Canha, which.
Right. Adding in Bader, Alvarez, and Beatty.
Yeah, like...
From 2 years ago.
Bader isn't going to be significantly worse than Mark Canha offensively. And
maybe a little less pop.
Brett Beatty will probably be better than Eduardo Escobar. And then Mark Vientos and J.D. Stewart at the DH spot will be better than Darren Ruff and Daniel Vogelbach.
From your mouth to whatever baseball god has been hating us for years and years.
So, I mean, what's there to say about the Mets? I mean, they're in transition. They won 75 games last year. They got a new manager. They got a new president of baseball ops. They are always a mess, but they're always fun to watch, and I always love them.
Are they fun to watch, though?
Yes, they are. They're always fun
to watch. Senga got hurt like 2 days in.
I know. Dave
Peterson, you know, he had hip surgery in November instead of like September.
These things, they happen to every team. It's just amplified. And it's only because the Mets won in 69 and 86. Had they not won, they were fun and lovable losers up until 69. Everyone still
loved them. Now they're just losers.
Exactly. So,
who's your X factor here, if there is one?
My X factor is Senga and Diaz. Edwin Diaz.
Right, Diaz can break.
Yeah. Was literally the reason that the team fell off from the start last year.
You know, I'm going to say my X factor is the Beatty Vientos combination.
I like that.
Someone's got to win that job. It's been Beatty's to lose for the last 3 years, it feels like. Vientos has been literally told to wait his turn. Now he's going to platoon at DH with DJ Stewart. Again,
I'll get a bad start.
Vientos isn't really getting the looks that people think he deserves. But I'm very curious to see how this third base matchup, the duel essentially, is going to come out and who's going to come on top and how.
Based on spring training. Defensively, kind of feels like Brett Beatty is because he's playing way more at third base.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you know, it's Beatty's job to lose. Has been since he got drafted, it feels like.
Yeah. I mean, he was a first round pick. He was
Vientos was top, what, second rounder?
Top 15. Vientos was a second rounder. Yep. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, Brett Beatty has the makings. Unlike Tony Soprano, Brett Beatty has the makings of a varsity athlete. I know you don't get it because you never watched Sopranos, but to our Soprano listeners, you're welcome. Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that's where it is. And Dakota has them at 83 wins.
So generous.
And they won 75 last year. So where do you generous. Have them?
Like, I want to go with our typical 72 and 90, dude. I really do.
Oh, you know, of course, 72 and 90. That's my choice, of course.
That's inevitable.
No, I have a real one this year.
Yeah, I'll go. This is a 500 ball club. It's either going to be a 500 ball club, 72 and 90, or they're going to win 87 games and sneak into the playoffs. Yeah. This is a team that could patch things together if needed.
Do you think they're like relatively equal to the Marlins?
Yeah, but with a lot more laughability.
Interesting. I think the Mets are better than the Marlins by quite a bit. The Mets offense is really good. It really is.
On paper, they are significantly better.
Their offense was better last year, too.
Yeah, no. Again, on paper, they're significantly better.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, they're still the Mets.
So you have them at 81 and 81, 500.
I'll go 84. I'll go 84. 84?
You think 84 wins?
I'll go 84 wins.
Wow. So over Pacoda. I'm going under. I'm going 79-83. Yeah.
Yeah, no, they're going to do just enough to hurt us.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm thinking like we get eliminated from the wild card on like September 12th, not 12th, 25th type thing.
Yeah, probably.
And an extra inning loss to God knows who.
Yeah, probably.
Either that or in Milwaukee on the last weekend of the series because Milwaukee just decides to ruin our life.
Yeah. And also, like, obviously because we're way more knowledgeable with the Mets, I have the rookies, and it's the pitching trio, which we could very easily see any three of them come up this year.
Oh, Hamill,
Vassell, Stewart. And
who?
Stewart.
Yes.
So we could very easily see any three of them, or maybe all three of them.
Dude, Jet Williams to come up, man.
And he's another one to watch. He is very talented. I think he's
going to make... has an ETA at 2028.
Yeah, they're dumb. He'd be 25. Or I guess he'd be 24. But still, that's dumb. The kid, there's a good chance we see him probably make a jump up to AAA this year.
Yeah, and maybe big leagues by September.
Maybe. It all depends. It depends on the structure of everything. But
let me ask you this. Who's the first arm that comes up out of the trio?
Probably Vassell.
I think so, too.
I think he's the most...
Although Hamill's the one that's still in camp.
Yes. Yeah. So. Hamill, it's one of them, too. But, I mean, who knows? Maybe Stewart is like... Maybe he's just so damn good. Like, he was really good last year. So maybe he's so damn good that he just forces it, you know? It's possible.
It's got to be Blade. Come on now. Great baseball name.
Blade? He's got another year. But
Blade did well. Let's go to the Phillies. Phillies. Have decided to just become an October team.
They're going to be putting out the same exact team for the 3 years in a row.
Yeah. With the exception of like Rojas now this year. But
yeah. 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 I mean, you know, little changes.
Right. Rojas Pache. This year they added Whit Merrifield.
Yeah. But
that's it. Spencer Turnbull they added to the pen. Ooh. That's it.
Yeah. Same team.
That's it, man.
Same team. Negative war, Kyle Schwarber with his... He'll hit 40 bombs. And
I forgot they had David Dahl, too, as a free agent.
200 as a leadoff hitter. Trey Turner. I'm just going to get out of the way. Trey Turner is the X factor. He was clearly the light of the offense and team when he turned it on last year. You know? So
Yeah, definitely. It's one of those things where... This is the team where they're getting older, right? But it's the same team as you said, same team for the last 3 years. They're getting older.
Yep.
At what point does the performance decline? Obviously, guys like Bryce Harper, Trey Turner, Real Muto, these are guys who they're top of their, top tier, upper tier baseball players, Castellanos even. But it's It's time that Bohm and Stott take the next step. And they showed that last year. They did. They showed it last year. They need to take the next step. And the other thing, Christopher Sanchez needs to take that next step.
Yeah.
You know what you're getting out of the rest of the rotation? Suarez, Nola, Wheeler, who just got a 3-year, $126 million extension. And I have some fun notes on that in a minute. But you know what you're getting with this ball club? You know what you're getting out of the pen, which is usually a heart attack, high blood pressure.
Yeah.
Sounds like 2015 Mets.
Jose Alvarado is going to be their closer. Nah, it's got to be
Soto. I would say put Soto in as closer.
I'll do Dominguez. Soto's way too wild.
That's true.
Got to go with Dominguez.
But you know, again, you know what you're getting with this ball club. And that's really not much you can say about that. By the way, what does Pecota have him at?
Pecota has him at 84.
Really?
Yep.
I'm going to go 88.
What were you going to say? 6 or 7?
7.
I have him at 87. Yeah, I have
him. I'm not really sure where I want to put him. Yeah.
And literally because of what you said, that's really why I have him at a 3-win loss. They're putting out the same exact team. It's an older team now, though. Like, these guys are the most, like, really, like, what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 guys out of their starters are under 30.
Over 30.
Are under 30.
Oh. No, yeah. Misread it. Under 30. Yep, you're right.
6 guys are under 30. Like, that's an issue. That's an issue. Now, and like you said, these guys are aging. The Phillies have a window. It is closing what seems like rapidly. Extremely fast. And there's a good chance. Which is
weird.
It is weird. But there's a good chance with, I mean, we'll see what they do next winter. Will be very telling of the Phillies' future direction.
Mm-hmm.
And how much that they play in the Juan Soto sweepstakes.
Right, because at that point, you got to get rid of Kyle Schwarber, and Brandon Marshall has to become expendable at that point.
And, well, and
really expand
aren't
your
Schwarber
outfield.
And Castellanos, aren't they free agents next year?
I think Castellanos is another year after this year, oh, I believe.
I thought it was an option.
It might be, but...
I mean, it doesn't matter.
We mentioned
they're not here for more than 2 more years. They're, you know, like,
right. You have to figure out how you're going to replace those quick. 2 bats.
And if, like you said, if Bryson Stott and Alec Bohm do not become what they were supposed to become,
yeah, they're both top 15 draft picks.
Yeah. It's going to turn into an issue where they didn't produce, and now you have Bryce Harper and Trey Turner and a 40-year-old JT Realmuto, you know.
Like, and again, I'm not saying that Bohm and Stott are bad by any means.
No,
but they're serviceable and slightly above average.
Yeah, I'm Bryson Stott. Well, actually, that makes sense to where I'm going. He's a good defender,
yes,
and he's a good base runner, and he has his moments with the bat where he has
real more often than not. Yeah.
But an Alec Bohm, dude, top 3 draft pick, like you got
the Mets too.
Yes, that's what I remember. I was praying
bullet.
I was praying. But yeah, what year was that? 18?
18.
So who did we draft that year? Kelenic.
Fucking A. Yeah.
Oh, man. Worked out.
Here's my note on Wheeler. And you know, 3 years, $126 million. Brody Van Wagenen's kicking himself. So Wheeler, total with Philadelphia, with including his extension, 8 years, $244 million.
Yeah.
That's a steal for Zach Wheeler, the way he's pitched the last few years. And if you continue that total contract is going to be a steal.
Yep.
I'll tell you how it looks like a steal already without him playing another game. Anthony Rendon with the Angels. 7 years for $245 million. Wheeler in Philly. 101 games, 111, including playoffs.
Mm-hmm.
Rendon in the LA. 200 games, 200 including playoffs. Both players have 4 years left on their deals. Phillies fans, say what you want. This is a great deal.
Well said.
Check out the podcast on the network, on the Power Play, Bricked Up. I mean, Bricked Up, fantastic. These guys have done a great job rebranding. On the Power Play, the trade deadline is today. Actually, we released the episode.
Yeah.
But a flurry of moves. Adam was going crazy. Had Jeff Quick on as the fill-in for Brian and Matt. What am I missing? Follow us on all socials. TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, or X. OnlyFans, YouTube. We don't actually have an OnlyFans yet.
Yeah.
More video content coming when the weather gets nicer. Billy and I actually got outside and threw a ball around. How's your shoulder feeling, by the way?
Oh, my shoulder's fine. I was short-arming that shit.
Don't know how much content Billy's going to be in when it comes to pitching, but I know there's some video content on the way when the weather gets nice. So keep an eye out on all of our social channels. Go give us a follow, like, subscribe, download, rate, review, all the good stuff. Billy, anything else? Spring breakdown's going to be fun. I think it's next week.
Yep. Yeah, I know the Mets is on the 15th. Yeah, next Friday.
And we're going to get the Jackson Holliday versus Paul Skeens, hopefully on television this time.
Probably not. They don't listen. No.
Anything else?
That's all I got, man. See you next week with the second.
Peace.
It's Tito Made.
Who the fuck is Dave?
I'm proud of you.